well.
Amen.
And broadcasting. I think I've got the red light. Hearing me loud and clear? Yes, that's grand. Welcome to worship today, everyone here in the sanctuary. Anyone joining us by the live stream, we welcome you and bid you a warm welcome on this wintry, cool morning. But you're very welcome to worship today. I'm going to invite you to join with me in the call to worship. Sorry, I should just refer to all the invitations that are printed on the back of the service. Please do read the invitations and act on them appropriately, and we commend them to you. And so to our call to worship, and if you would join in the white print as we gather together in worship today. Come, let us gather.
In the presence of God and one another.
Come, let us gather.
And worship God our Maker.
Come, let us gather.
We open our hearts to God.
So we worship God in the words of the hymn number 181, For the Beauty of the Earth. In the budding of the daffodil, We see colourful crocuses beginning to dot lawns and gardens. And we see in this spectacle your very fingerprints. So often when we touch things, we leave behind smudgy residues of our sinfulness. But when you touch creation, O Father, you leave behind bright traces of glory. You dapple the landscape of our lives with radiant hues of yellow, deep tones of purple, and the flashes of gold as buds push outward on the edge of a branch. When we open our mouths, too often we let them gush forth with curses or words that are said in anger. When you open your holy mouth, Lord God, we hear the chorus of the robin's song, the warble of the goldfish, the pure liquid melody of the birds. Today we confess to you, O God, our past unfaithfulness, our pride and hypocrisy and impatience. We confess our self-indulgent appetites and ways and our exploitation of other people. We confess our intemperate love of worldly goods and comforts and our dishonesty in daily work and life. We confess our negligence in prayer and worship and our failure to commend the faith that is in us. Do be pleased to hear our confessions. We thank you for your promise that when we confess our sins, you're faithful and just to forgive us and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Eternal God, there is right now so much that is wrong with this world, so much that causes anxiety and fear and deep sadness. Yet the springtime renewal of life reminds us that in your hands there is so much that is right. Help us to see in the springtime not simply a natural cycle that repeats itself each year, but instead help us to see deeper down into the dear promise of the gospel itself. Help us to see in each daffodil not a fleeting glimpse of beauty that must soon fade away, but an enduring glimpse of the glory you have promised us and all creatures because of who Jesus Christ is and what he has done. Eternal God, help us to find hope in a hopeless age, peace in a time of war, joy in a world of sorrow. Cause us to sing lyrically in a cacophonous era of shouting and confusion and chaos. Receive our thanks and praise for all that is right and good and proper and radiant with hope. In all our travelling, may your footsteps guide us. In all our journeying to work and returning, may your footsteps guide us. Within our homes and families, may your footsteps guide us. In our leisure time together, may your footsteps guide us. In difficult situations and conflict, may your footsteps guide us. As we stumble on the way, may your footsteps guide us. In the travelling of our faith, may your footsteps guide us. As we place our trust in you, may your footsteps guide us. And hear us now as we are bold to say together the words that Jesus has taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father in heaven, may your holy name be honored. May your kingdom come. May your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today the food we need, and forgive us the wrongs we have done, as we forgive the wrongs that others have done to us. Do not bring us to heart testing, but keep us safe from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours forever. Say it with flowers. We use flowers to say things to people, especially when we find it very hard to use words. We use flowers to say well done to someone perhaps who's won a prize or a competition or a race. We use flowers to say how sorry we are when someone is sick or sad because they've lost someone close to them. We use flowers to say congratulations when someone's celebrating a special event like a birthday. And next Sunday, I think we'll use flowers for our mums to thank them for all that they do to us. Say it with flowers, and particular flowers, flowers have a language all of their own, and different flowers say different things. Roses, especially red roses, speak of a deep love. carnations, especially white ones, say, "Remember me." The snowdrop meekly says to us, "Spring is coming." And the daffodil exuberantly claims that spring is here. Jesus knew that flowers could speak to us. You maybe remember his words in Matthew's Gospel. He says, "Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They do not labor and spin, yet not even Solomon in all his glory was dressed like one of these." And today I haven't brought any flowers with me, but I want you to imagine a flower with five petals. A flower with five petals. And each of those petals tell us something that flowers say to us. And I want to link them also with words from the Bible, from Psalm 139. But here's the first thing, the first words in the first petal of our flower, and it says, "I'm thinking of you." We send flowers to people, especially when we're thinking of them, when they've had a hard time or some difficulty or some problem, when they're sick at home or in hospital, we send them flowers. "I'm thinking of you." And in that psalm that I mentioned, it says, "You know when I sit and when I rise, you perceive my thoughts from afar. How precious to me are your thoughts, O God. How vast is the sum of them." So just think about this. If you could count up the number of God's thoughts about us, they would be more than the number of grains of sand on the beach. How many is that? Billions and billions and billions. So God is always thinking of us, just as when we send flowers and we're thinking of other people. It's good to know that when life is tough and difficult, God is always thinking of us. And the next petal of the flower says, "You are special." Flowers often say this. We say this to people when we give them flowers. When we give flowers to our moms next week, they'll be saying to them that they are special. And the psalm tells us that God hems us in behind and before. He lays his hands upon us. "Such knowledge is too wonderful for me, too lofty to attain." So although there are millions and millions of people in the world, we are each special to God. Everyone is special. It's as if God has touched each of our lives. There's a chorus that says, "I'm special because God has loved me, for he gave the best thing he had to save his own son Jesus, crucified to take the blame. I'm special." So that's the second petal. And then the next petal is, "When I consider." When I consider. When we give flowers to someone, we think of all that they have done for us. The love and the care and attention they've given to us. Sometimes we give them recognition of something well done, an exam passed or a race completed, or a race won or a job completed. And we should think of all that God has done for us. God has provided each and every day that we have. And then the fourth petal says, "Thank you." That's another thing that flowers say when we give them to other people. We're saying thank you to the important people in our lives. Thank you for all they've done. And the psalmist thanks God that he is fearfully and wonderfully made, he says. Just think of flowers and how fearfully and wonderfully made they are, with the shape and the colour and the smell, all the beauty of the flowers. And just as God has made all the flowers, God has made us, and he has made us well. And then the final petal is sorry. Sometimes we give flowers as a peace offering, we say. We know we've done someone an injury. Not maybe on purpose, but by accident. And we want to send them a peace offering. And so we send them flowers to say we're sorry. We didn't mean to hurt them or to annoy them in any way. And the psalmist reminds us that we need to say to God, "Search me and know my heart. See if there is any wicked way in me." And so we say sorry to God for all that he has done for us. So we're going to think about flowers further in our next hymn. It's the hymn 155. "Think of a world without any flowers. Think of a world without any trees." Hymn 155.
Thank you. morning comes from Isaiah, in the page 725 of your Bibles. Read Isaiah 41, verses 1 to 10. The passage is entitled, The Helper of Israel. Be silent before me, you islands. Let the nations renew their strength. Let them come forward and speak. Let us meet together at the place of judgment. Who has stirred up one from the east, calling him in righteousness to his service? He hands nations over to him and subdues kings before him. He turns them to dust with his sword, to wind-blowing chaff with his bow. He pursues them and moves on unscathed, by a path his feet have not travelled before. Who has done this and carried it through, calling forth the generations from the beginning? I, the Lord, with the first of them and with the last, I am he. The islands have seen it and fear. The ends of the earth tremble. They approach and come forward. Each helps the other and says to his brother, Be strong. The craftsman encourages the goldsmith, and he who smooths with the hammer spurs on him who strikes with the anvil. He says of the welding, It is good. He nails down the idol so that it will not topple. But you, O Israel, my servant, Jacob, whom I have chosen, you descendants of Abraham, my friend, I took you from the ends of the earth, from its furthest corners, I called you. I said, You are my servant, I have chosen you, and have not rejected you. So do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. And our New Testament reading is from the book of Romans, Romans 5, and that can be found on page 1132 of the Pew Bibles. Romans 5, reading from verses 1 to 5, and the passage is entitled Peace and Joy. Therefore, since we have been justified through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have gained access by faith into this grace in which we now stand. And we rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. Not only so, but we also rejoice in our sufferings, because we know that suffering produces perseverance. Perseverance, character, and character, hope. And hope does not disappoint us, because God has poured out his love into our hearts by the Holy Spirit, whom he has given us. May the Lord add his blessings to these holy readings from his holy word, and to be his name all praise and glory.
Thank you, Lord. We sing our next hymn. The hymn is hymn 601, Look Upon Us, Blessed Jesus. 601.
Oh,
light of light from the Father proceeding. So grant us light, grant entrance, grant the entrance of your light into our minds and our hearts. Speak to us, Lord, for we your servants are listening. And all we ask, through your Son, Jesus Christ. It seems to be that season of the year again, the season of the dreaded cones that indicate roadworks and all that goes with that, inconvenience or bumper-to-bumper traffic. We can come across these cones at any time of the year, but for some reason, late winter, early spring seems to be the time when the cones are at their most visible. Why? I don't know. Is it something to do with the road service spending all their allocation of government grants before the end of the financial year at the beginning of April, perhaps? I do recall being on a fly-dry holiday in the United States of America, and suddenly, in the midst of driving our hard car, the traffic began to slow and then snarl, and soon we were at a complete stop. And for a matter of 3, 4, 5 minutes, we didn't move an inch. Many of the drivers around us became irritable, and they started to honk their horns. In a few moments, the car started to move again slowly, and we went over the crest of a hill, and soon we saw the reason for the delay. There were roadworks. But instead of a sign that simply stated that, the sign that we saw said this: construction ahead, prepare for immediate aggravation. So what a wonderful way to put it. Prepare for immediate aggravation. And isn't that true? As you ride along the highway of life, that sometimes you can be cruising along, everything seems as if it's going really smoothly, and then out of the blue, I mean, you're not expecting it, there's a jolt, a bolt, comes out of the blue, and suddenly, without warning, your plans are delayed and you're stopped. It's particularly difficult if you've got a deadline and there's somewhere you've got to be and the traffic isn't moving. On the highway of life, there is no sign that says construction ahead, prepare for immediate aggravation. We have to deal with those things that just hit us out of the blue. Today or this week, something could hit you out of the blue, and there's no sign, it will just hit you out of nowhere. And in the difficult moments, there is no sign. Prepare for immediate aggravation. Prepare for a crisis. Prepare for a difficulty. Prepare for a death. It just hits us out of nowhere, and suddenly we have to deal with it. Sometimes you wake up in the morning and you find that a partner has a heart attack, and it was swift and it happened in an instant, in the twinkling of an eye. Some of you have had a boss who called you in out of the blue on a Friday morning and said, "We're phasing out your area of the company, clean out your desk by 5 o'clock. And you didn't see it coming. And it hits you out of the blue and there was no sign. Prepare for it. Today, something is going to hit you and it just hits. Or maybe you're at the office, or you get a call on your mobile, or you get an email that your mother has gone into hospital and you weren't expecting it, or your brother-in-law calls and says your sister's tumour is malignant, and oh boy, it hits you swift and hard because you weren't expecting it. It hits you right out of nowhere. T.S. Eliot says, "Every now and then, life drops an unavoidable question at your door." And the unavoidable question of this Sunday sermon is this: where do you turn? Where do you go? What do you do when out of the blue, when you're not expecting it, life hits you swift and hard, and a blow comes your way? What do you do in that moment? Where do you turn in that moment? Who gives you comfort and solace and strength in that moment? How do you get the strength to go on and take another step after something like that has happened? Do To whom do you turn? On whom do you lean in that moment? And I believe God drew us here because God wants us to remember this message, that He will hold us. He will hold on to us. He will not shield us from all the pain. He will not eliminate all the suffering. He will not eliminate all the adversity. The problems and the vicissitudes of life are real for Christians and non-Christians, but God says, in the midst of the suffering, in the midst of the pain, I will hold on to you. I will hold you in my everlasting arms, and I will never, ever, ever let you go. That's the message for today. It's a message that you need to hear, and I need to hear, and the people of Israel needed to hear 1600 years ago when they were in exile in Babylon. They were cut off from their homeland of Palestine, where they worshipped in the temple. And when they went to the temple to worship in their own land, they were sure that God was with them. God was present, they believed, in the Ark of the Covenant and in the Holy of Holies. But suddenly, in 587 BC, when Nebuchadnezzar and the Babylonians conquered them and destroyed their temple and took them off into captivity in Babylon, the Israelites wondered, can we worship God in a strange land? Where is God? Is God going to be with us in this strange land? And as they were in exile for many years, the prophet Isaiah gave them these words of hope that Donald read for us this morning. Yes, I will redeem you. I will restore you. I will take you back to your homeland. I will rebuild the temple. I will rebuild what has been destroyed and all the destructions of the cities. I will rebuild the land. But did you catch the thing in Isaiah 41 when Isaiah said, ultimately, your home is not in Palestine. Your home is not in the temple. Your home is in the everlasting arms of God. I will hold you, he said, with my strong right arm, and I will never let you go, no matter what. Verse 10, fear not, I am with you. Be not dismayed, I am your God. I will strengthen you. Yes, I will help you. I will hold you with my righteous right arm. We all know Psalm 23. Many of us memorized it when we were children. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for God is with me. Thou art with me. God is holding us, and God will never, ever let us go. You know when it's particularly hard to remember that? I think it's particularly hard when you feel you've let God down, or when you feel as if you've disappointed God. When you feel a little unclean, or as if you've done something you shouldn't have done, or said something you shouldn't have said, or when you and I fall in a pit, or we get in a predicament in life, and we feel estranged from God, or cut off from God, or alienated from God, and we wonder, where is God in that moment? It's particularly hard to remember God is reaching out to us. God is holding on to us, and will never let us go. I love the story of Jerry Clower, a pastor in Mississippi in the United States of America, a story that he tells. He and his wife were parents of five children. One day across from their home where they lived and their five children, who were all under nine by the way, and they looked out across the street and several of the homes were tarring their driveways and their roofs. And there was a big vat of tar outside in the street. And Jerry Clower and his wife said to their five children, now listen, you cannot go out. Don't go near that tar. Don't even go anywhere near that whole area. Please don't go over while they're doing that work. It's so messy. You're going to get covered with it. Well, one afternoon, Jerry Clower's wife looked out the window and saw, to her horror, their five-year-old looking around, sneaking around, making sure nobody was watching him, and he climbed up the side of a stepladder, He just wanted to look over into the vat of tar. But as he looked over into that vat of tar beneath him, he lost his balance and he fell over the side into the tar. Just as quick as she could, Jerry Carr's wife raced across the street, climbed up the step ladder, reached down and was pulling the little boy out of the vat of jar, the vat of tar. And as she was pulling him out, she was thinking, oh well, there's one in, there might as well have all five in, but that didn't happen. But she said it would be a lot easier to have not just one to clean up, but however, that wasn't the way. She did clean him up, and in doing so, she got covered with tar all over as she restored the little boy to wholeness. Sometimes you and I, though God tells us we shouldn't do it, are curious. We're not going to fall in. Nobody's going to know. We look around, nobody's watching. It's not going to happen to us. And we climb the little stepladder. We look around. Nobody's watching, so we peer over and we just want to see what's going on. Nothing's going to happen to us. And before we know it, we've toppled into the tar. And now everybody knows. Jesus Christ doesn't say, I told you so, you shouldn't have done that. He comes running over to us, climbing down right into our predicament, reaches right down, grabs us by the hand, pulls us up, and in the process of saving us, he becomes covered with the grime and the tar and the sin of your life and mine. You see, that's why he's our Saviour. He comes right to our predicament, right to the place where we are lost. He comes right to us in that place and he reaches out, holds on to us, pulls us out, but in the process gets messy himself. I don't want anyone to forget this message. I don't want anyone ever to forget that when we are in the tar of life, God will reach out, pull us out, and he'll hold on to us with the tenacity of a bulldog. And he'll never let us go. Never forget that. Some of us maybe are having a rough time ahead. Perhaps I'm looking out into the faces of people and your job uncertainty is worse than it's ever been. Maybe I'm looking at some in the congregation who face difficult decisions and you're at a difficult crossroads and you say, how am I going to make it? Well, the way you're going to make it is that God is going to hold on to us with the tenacity of a bulldog. We're going to find our true home in his everlasting arms. And he's never going to let us go. It doesn't mean we won't lose our job. It doesn't mean we won't lose our health, as we've known it up until now. It means that he will be with us and is our ultimate home. There may be no sign that says, prepare for immediate aggravation. But remember that God will hold on to us with the tenacity of a bulldog. And he will never let us go. In 1834, Catherine Hankey was born in the United Kingdom, in Great Britain, here. And she grew up in a wonderful Christian family. She became a deeply committed Christian. And then in 1864, at the age of 30, she contracted a very serious disease. And the doctors never thought she would live. But she did. During her years of recuperation, when she was bedridden, she sat with a pencil and a pad and would write things. She wrote long poems, one of which was called The Story Told. And in the poem, she told the story of how, even when she was in her dark hours of pain, God was with her. God held onto her, and God would never let her go. And as she felt a little better, she wanted to tell the story. And so she went to the streets of London and taught Sunday school classes to children on the streets of London. She started Sunday schools for the poor and for the rich, but not for church kids. Her classes were designed for the unchurched. And this movement became so popular that it spread throughout our kingdom, throughout Great Britain. And about 1870, one of these poems was found, and someone looked at it and set it to music. As a result, we have the hymn with which we're going to end the service today, Tell Me the Old, Old Story. The bulldog could be a symbol of that. a symbol, not that God will always put a guard sheet around us so nothing will happen to us, but a symbol that God will hold on to us. He will hold on to us with his everlasting arms, and he will give us the strength and never let us go. We don't ever know what the future holds, but we know who holds the future, and his name is Jesus Christ. And he will hold on to you with the tenacity of a bulldog when you fall down and into the tar pit of life. He comes after you and rescues you, and he will pull you out, and he will hold on to you with the tenacity of a bulldog, and he will never, ever, ever, ever let you go. Amen. And to God's name be the glory and the praise forever and ever. Amen. We sing our hymn 536, May the Mind of Christ My Saviour. Hymn 536. Assuring them that they bear the dignity of being the child of a great king, a status nothing and no one can remove. Remind them that nothing can separate them from your love that is in Christ Jesus, even in the latter years of the winding down of life. Be with all in our society who exist on the dim margins of our collective consciousness. Provide light for those who so often stumble in the darkness. Grant healing and proper medical care to the chronically sick, the addicted and for the abused. Help us collectively in church and society to find food for the hungry, especially for children, and clothing for the ill-clad. Give us both the clarity of vision that helps us to see people's needs and the wisdom to meet those needs in meaningful and lasting ways. Bring peace at long last in all places that for too long have known only war and rumours of war. We continue to pray for the Ukraine, where there is stubborn resolve and tunnel vision on both sides of this or that divide. Soften hearts and expand vision, O Lord. Where there is hatred that simmers all the time, boiling over at times in the form of a tank smashing the house of the innocent, or a person blowing himself up to kill innocent people, end this insanity by the same direction of your Spirit, O God. Too often we seem to see no way out of various spiralling conflicts. So also we pray that peace, even as we own up to the sneaking suspicion in the back of our minds that peace seems forever to elude so many parts of this globe. So surprise us again, Father, work through our prayers for a greater justice, a greater respect for life on all sides, a greater peace, all greater than we can even imagine. Lift our sight higher so that we can strive towards other loftier goals in coming days. Remind us of your abiding love and grace so that we can become beacons of love and grace to neighbours and friends. Anoint our eyes to see your image residing deep within each person we meet. Anoint our ears to hear the cries of all that surround us, especially the needy. Anoint our hands to do your work. Anoint our lips to speak your peace so that in all ways, in all times, in all places, we may glorify you. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, we are bold to pray these things, and all we ask, and all we pray, in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, to whom be glory and praise forever and ever. Amen. We are going to bring our service to conclusion with Catherine Hankey's hymn. It does say 714, but that's 714 in the third edition, so it's not in the fourth edition, so I'm afraid you will have to follow by the screen. Tell me the old, old story in 714, third edition.
Oh,
now may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit rest and abide with you this day and forevermore.